Finally finished Sucker Punch's Ghost of Tsushima. And let me tell you, this game is one that hits you directly in your feels. Even for its criticisms, Ghost of Tsushima is easily one of the most life-changing games I've ever played. And I don't mean that it's just superficial hyperbole either. If you've been following me for a while through Norse Caesar, or you're as new to my voice as my videos on Black Girls Anime, then you'll know that in almost every video I've ever done, that along with being autistic and living with various other neurodivergencies, my love for and continued studying of psychology, sociology, and writing are not only the essence of these analyses and reviews, but a means I use to try and provide people with a real-life glimpse and perspective into how someone like me sees and interacts and perceives this world on a day-to-day basis. That said, in the entirety of my gaming history, stemming from the age of 5 and onwards, I've actually never played an open-world game. Which, you know, I'll admit is pretty mind-boggling when you consider that GTA 5, Red Dead Redemption, and Red Dead 2 are three of my all-time favorite games that I've literally never played. Best believe, I've dedicated countless hours to watching the playthroughs on YouTube, studying the lore of all three games, the character narratives, the Easter eggs, and every random fact that my brain could possibly soak up without ever having to play the game, in the hopes that I'll one day have the opportunity to actually play them. And honestly, before you write me off as being either lazy or a fake nerd, one of the main reasons I've actually never gotten around to playing these games back when they first dropped is that at the time, let's just say that I wasn't in the best place in life to focus on a video game for a system I certainly couldn't afford. Still, these three games are but a simple few out of probably hundreds of games on my mental backlog that I'm trying to catch them on playing. Well, that and because I honestly didn't think I'd fare too well with open world games, to the point where my anxiety had me avoiding them at all costs. The sensory overload of open world games can be very intense, especially for people like me who struggle with sensitivity to sensory stimulation in any capacity. That's why I can't even begin to describe the mixture of excitement and anxiety that coiled its sinewy fingers around me as I mentally committed to the fact that yes, Ghost of Tsushima will in fact be my first open world game. All the while banking on that if it went well enough, I could gradually begin to open myself more to not only a new genre of open world games, but other genres as well, such as tactical and stealth series as a whole. To no one's total surprise, mine included, my first playthrough could only be described as fast times at anxiety high, as I literally struggled to learn, adjust, and adapt to every aspect of this game, from the camera angles to the entirety of the open world map, and the very specific and rapid fire button controls. Yo, let me tell you, these bamboo strikes had me tight! And switching between the endless arsenal of weapons, well, let's just say that in the early days of playing the game, I was constantly reminded of why I'd always avoided open world games. I even began to think, yeah, maybe these games are just too much for someone like me, which was obviously just my anxiety trying to bully me into quitting the game completely. But there was just something about Ghost of Tsushima that made me buckle down and commit to seeing this game through to completion. And more so than seeing it completed, this game became one of my all-time favorites, on par with that of Persona 5, Persona 5R, Pokemon, and other titles that have shaped my life from its very earliest stages. Actually, it wasn't just some vague particular something. It was the beautiful visuals, the engaging story, the questionable concept of what morality looks like across different spectrums and perspectives, the incredibly engaging characters, the way the women are written. It was almost everything about this game. And as I slowly began to adjust to the controls, which, to be honest, I really haven't fully mastered all of them yet, but I'm learning, and found myself obsessing over needing to know what happened to one of my favorite characters, how their story would interact with my own as Jin Sakai, and where both their stories and ultimately mine would lead. Before I knew it, I found myself playing this game from anywhere between 18 to 20 hours a day, connecting deeper and deeper and in more relatable ways with Jean and the other cast of well-written characters that when it all came to an end, it left me with a lot to process. All that said, I've sorted through my complex feelings for Ghost of Tsushima and will be presenting my findings in both today's Top 10 Tuesdays of why you should definitely play Ghost of Tsushima, as well as a more fleshed out in-depth analysis and review of the series as a whole for Think About It Thursdays and my next noir analysis. So, without further ado, and in a properly spoiler-free fashion, and listed, of course, in no specific order, here are the top 10 reasons why you need to play Ghost of Tsushima if you already haven't. Number 1, the visuals. Let's be honest here. The stunning visuals are what initially draw you in and refuse to let go. I remember looking at this trailer and thinking aloud, I need this game. From the absolutely dizzying arrays of gold and yellow that paint the landscapes of the Adachi Estate and the Golden Temple in hues reminiscent of an autumn sunrise, to the sorrowful reds of the resilient maple tree that sets the stage for many of GOT's iconic scenes. The sheer beauty of this game can only be summed up as Sucker Punch effectively capturing lightning and colorful glass bottles designed to reflect the vibrant and somber tones of this game. This only enhances the multiple ways to experience this game, including standard, subtitled, samurai, and Kurosawa mode, with the latter being an homage to the iconic Japanese film director Akira Kurosawa, meant to replicate the art and film style of Kurosawa's oldest and notable samurai and shogun-inspired movies. movies, which includes adding a black and white filter to your gameplay, as well as the addition of audio tracks that truly takes you back to the days of 40s, 50s, and 60s cinema. My advice to new players? Stick to standard mode on your first playthrough. That way you can first experience all of the vibrant colors and visual aesthetics that can ostensibly be drowned out in Kurosawa mode, and then play through the game a second time a la Kurosawa mode. Number 2, the story. Unlike many games on the market that shall not be named, Ghost of Tsushima is more than just a beautiful game. There is an underlying and persisting story that centers not only the main story of Jin's ascension as the vengeful ghost, but also on the narratives of both Jin's allies, as well as the numerous side characters you'll undoubtedly counter in this game. Ghost of Tsushima is not a subtle game, yet it's written in such a way that it allows players to use their own imagination to fill in the blanks, for better or for worse. Of course, one of the most integral stories to unlock is none other than your own. As you make progress over the course of the game, certain choices that you make will affect not only the main story, as well as the character dialogue, but will impact the very nature of the weather on the island of Tsushima as well. The game does a fantastic job of establishing that yes, your supposed quote-unquote well-meaning actions certainly have consequences, and sometimes on a more devastating scale than you could have possibly ever imagined. So if you're someone who enjoys a good psychological masterpiece that brilliantly employs the use of multiple subtle morality-based systems, then Ghost of Tsushima absolutely needs to be on your list of games to play. Number 3, the unique cast of characters. If you're a true empath like me, then you're far more likely than your friends or your family to become deeply attached and emotionally invested in the characters and narrative of whatever video game, anime, manga, books, or characters you happen to be working on. That said, and in my own humble opinion, it's incredibly easy to get attached to Jin and the other beautifully flawed characters in this game. In order to 100% shot the game, you're going to be spending a considerable amount of time bonding with and getting to know this game's eclectic cast of characters. Something else Sucker Punch effectively utilizes is the use of subtext in regards to getting to know the characters. You're both figuratively and literally given their individual and shared history piece by piece. Even then, your imagination is kind of left to its own devices to gleam and dissect the truth behind what seem like simple lines of throwaway dialogue, which in turn can reveal the inner demons as well as the joys that drive and shape each character, including the titular ghost of whom story you're navigating. Emotionally and psychologically, this game will take it out of you, particularly physically given how hard I cried, and I mean ugly cried, if you become too invested in its characters. And that's not at all a bad thing. Quite the contrary. It shows that the people at Sucker Punch know exactly what it takes to make characters effectively relatable and sympathetic. Even when those same allies go so far as to turn on you, I always experienced some level of hesitation when it came time to battle them, desperately seeking for a way to preserve the bond we'd built up over a 40 plus hour playthrough. One thing I've absolutely got to give Sucker Punch its roses for is that when it comes to the way the women characters are written, I found the handling of their individual stories, particularly in relation to the male-dominated time period this was handled incredibly well. They genuinely felt like real, believable characters who can stand perfectly independent and outside of the shadow of Jin, the male protagonist. Their physical, emotional, and psychological strength is entirely their own, and stands apart from Jin in such a way that their stories humble him significantly and continue to remind him of his very privileged life, especially when his life is held up to the mirror of the life that Yuna and her beloved brother Taka experienced. What's incredibly important to note is that all of the characters outside of Jin feel equally, if not even more, real and relatable than Jin himself, providing this game with an all-around engaging, very real and believable cast of characters that the player can connect with in a multitude of ways on various levels. Number 4, the gameplay mechanics are unique, refreshing, and fluid. For all of my gripes about the impressively infuriating amount of time it took me to master a certain bamboo strike with a complicated and specific number of button commands, I still found it a very useful and overall impressive bout of practice used to improve your overall dexterity and muscle memory needed to master certain moves within the game. At times, it truly felt as though I were a samurai trying to hone their skill. Of course, while Ghost of Tsushima is far from the first to utilize this type of subtle ongoing tutorial in the game's mechanics, the way it's presented is undeniably unique. Frankly, that's something this game doesn't get enough credit for. Many of the tactics we employ in Ghost of Tsushima are ones we've actually done in some capacity across other games on various other platforms and consoles. But Ghost of Tsushima utilizes innovative creativity to present these old and familiar mechanics to you in a refreshing and seemingly new light. However, it's also true that certain mechanics are entirely unique to Ghost of Tsushima as well, such as the use of the guiding wind feature, on top of the use of birds as a tool for directional-based navigation, among countless other features that makes Ghost of Tsushima the original creation that it is. Once you get the hang of the mini controls, the game naturally becomes significantly easier, and freedom of choice in how you want to dispose of the many enemies is left entirely in the hands of the player and Jin's impressive resume of both samurai and ghost tactics. The result being staggeringly beautiful combos combos executed through a mixture of fast-paced and slow-motion actions as you wield your weapon of choosing with style and finesse. I definitely can't close out this portion of the list without pointing out the unique weather-changing mechanic that, yes, provides an aesthetic and creative lens to Kurosawa mode and movie mode, but more importantly, serves as one of the game's few subtle morality systems meant to serve as a physical manifestation of your deeds as you ascend the path of the ghost. Number 5, the voice acting. Part of what helps endear you to the central characters of Ghost of Tsushima is the incredible voice acting of the carefully chosen cast in regards to both the Japanese and English dubbing. My first playthrough was in English, and as a result, I was treated to the stellar performances by an undoubtedly talented cast. Whether it was being lulled to the rich, almost sensual baritone of Jin Sakai's voice actor, the super fine Daisuke Tsuji, the heart-wrenching guttural cries of Lauren Tom as Lady Masako Adachi, and especially Sumire Montano's visceral performance as Yuna, the overall voice acting is nothing short of remarkable, and more importantly, a crucial piece of the puzzle that makes up Ghost of Tsushima's success. Number 6, the music. Oh! The entire soundtrack is an auditory marvel, composed in a way that not only complements the beautiful scenery and your narrative exploits across the game, but enhances it tenfold. The musical masterpiece that makes up the Ghost of Tsushima soundtrack can only be described as one of the best, most effective, and emotional video game OSTs of the last decade. Much of the music and overall sound pieces are worked into the game in such a way that's intended to let you know what all is going on around you, such as when there's an enemy nearby or when you're in the vicinity of one of Inari's many shrines. Music is also one of the game's many active mechanics, and one that sees Jin utilize his flute to change specific elements of the game. The last thing I want to touch upon are the interweaving vocals and how Sucker Punch effectively relegated them to moments during the game's highest of emotional and psychological apexes. To say you'll be left haunted by the memory of this soundtrack seems entirely fitting for Ghost of Tsushima. Number 7, the lore. If you're looking for historical accuracy, well, I'm not sorry to tell you that Ghost of Tsushima probably isn't the game for you. However, that's all part of the charm of this game. In choosing to play fast and loose with the original game's historical source material, this allows Sucker Punch to weave its own brand of original legends, lore, and customs that are entirely unique to the people and island of the fictional Tsushima. However, that's not to say the game's mythos is mired entirely in mystery. You'll find many real-life Japanese customs and rituals scattered throughout the game, whether it's praying at the shrines, bathing in the hot springs to cleanse your body or mind, taking in your surroundings to write a haiku, which, as a writer, is probably one of my favorite aspects of this game, or collecting charms meant to increase your powers that are said to be blessed by the gods themselves. It's up to you to unlock all of Tsushima's secrets, and that's just part of the fun of this game. Number 8, the attention to detail. It's glaringly obvious that Sucker Punch's attention to detail is just one of many things that drive this game. Whether it's the intricate, glistening design of the Mongol's armor, to the damp heaviness of Jean's tunic that remains wet for a time before drying off, even the seemingly tiniest of details contribute to the game being one hell of an audiovisual masterpiece. If you're a stickler for the finer details, Ghost of Tsushima is a treat in itself as you continue to unlock and discover the smallest observations that leave you feeling impacted by the game in a major way. Number 9, the glitches and bugs. I'm sure y'all are like, wait, what? How is this an incentive to play the game? Oh, ye of little imagination. Ghost of Tsushima contains more than its fair share of glitches and bugs that can range from positively infuriating to downright hilarious. Nevertheless, if you share the same twisted sense of humor with the crowd that popularized the infamous glitches of GTA and Red Dead, then you're in for a wild, confusing, and bloody good time, both literally and metaphorically. Number 10. The upcoming multiplayer DLC. One thing many fans of Ghost of Tsushima can agree upon is that this game would have been amazing with a multiplayer mode that sees you working with or against your friends and other players. Enter Sage Wright, the upcoming Ghost of Tsushima co-op multiplayer DLC, Legends, slated for PS4 release this fall. As the name suggests, this new multiplayer is a separate story from that of Jean's and surrounds four warriors of Tsushima who have made legends for themselves amongst the island. This new co-op multiplayer mode will allow up to 2 to 4 players and will offer a choice of 4 character classes with their own unique ability and advantages. Assassin, Samurai, Ronin, and Hunter. How will your legend unfold in the upcoming DLC? And that's it for this week's Top 10 Tuesdays. Tune in this Thursday for my full analysis and review of Ghost of Tsushima. Thanks for watching. Drop in the comments what you thought of Ghost of Tsushima, if I've inspired you to play it, and if you're looking forward to the new DLC. Don't forget to like this video, share it with your friends, and subscribe to North Caesar Entertainment and Black Girls Anime for more in-depth, informative, educational, and entertaining lists, analyses, and reviews of your favorite anime, manga, video games, and more.